broadcasting house in the heart of London, home of the BBC's biggest multimedia newsroom. Journalists working here write to be read, write to be listened to, and write for television. Same story, different storytelling skills. And I think it's important to remember in this multimedia age that writing for or with or to pictures is different from writing to be read or writing to be listened to. It's a skill that some just seem to have. It's a skill that others work hard to acquire, and it's a skill that some people never really quite get. In 25 years with the BBC, I've been fortunate to have worked with some of the best in the business of television news. I've watched them at their craft and occasionally even made myself useful. They're very different people, they're very different journalists, but when it comes to working with pictures, I believe they do have some things in common. This is a personal look at those shared traits. Now, if there's one thing that unites all of those who have a reputation for being able to write well to pictures, it's this. They look at the pictures. They really look at the pictures. The best in the business of television news understand the obvious, that at its best, television is about the pictures. I was working with royal correspondent Nicholas Witchell and picture correspondent Duncan Stone on that royal wedding day. We had a tiny edit suite just by Buckingham Gate. Next door was a sophisticated network logging operation that was designed to make sure no great shots were missed.
According to God's holy law.
According to God's holy law.
And thereto I give thee my troth.
And thereto I give thee my troth.
Nick was in the Abbey, but able to watch the main broadcast on a little TV. When he got back to start editing, his picture log, hastily scribbled in a notebook, was, rather irritatingly, better than anybody else's. A hugely experienced correspondent, Nick was totally across the pictures, his raw material.
The marriage register signed.
Prince William and his wife.
He hadn't just been vaguely watching, he'd been paying detailed attention.
And with the formalities over, it was a chance for some of the other principal players, best man and maid of honour, father of the groom and mother of the bride, to exchange views on how it had all gone. That's certainly something all the guests will have been discussing as they took their tales of the wedding home with them.
In my experience, the best correspondents say things like, "What's your best picture? Let's go through the rushes. What have we got?" More than this, they build in time for looking at the rushes, and crucially, they look at the pictures before they start writing. But what is it they're looking for? A great opening shot, a killer sequence, pictures that will tell the story. Of course, all of these things. But I believe they're also looking for something else, inspiration. That certain something in the picture that stimulates a line. It might be a landscape or something in it. It might be some action or some drama in the frame. It might be a face, an expression, an emotion. It might be a sound, perhaps a voice. It might be something that seems out of place, that somehow illuminates a story. Watch out for clichés. The teddy bear in the rubble of the earthquake has been done. But remember, it's concentrating on the pictures that gets the creative juices flowing. It's the pictures that inspire the memorable lines.
Mud is all they have to hold off the rising sea. Backbreaking labour to try to rebuild their island's defences. Under a monsoon sky, this is an apocalyptic scene. Workers toiling on an embankment wrecked by a storm last May. Without it, this community can't survive.
In the old Libya, where the prisoner's sky was just a patch of light, arrest was arbitrary and sentences could be indefinite or cut short by an execution. Fear still isn't far away in the new Libya's prisons. We were asked not to show the prisoners' faces.
If really watching the rushes is the first trait shared by those who write well for pictures, Then the second is listening to the rushes and understanding the importance of sound. Now, if you've got a good picture story on your hands, somebody is bound to say to you, let the pictures breathe. This isn't just about letting the shots run long. It's as much about the sound as the vision. The best picture editors will usually want a minimum of 10% of the allotted duration to break up the track with natural sound. A good script is written with that up sound in mind. Avoid editing in the pauses in the track. Build them into the structure of your script. One of the secrets of great writing to pictures is not writing at all.
For a moment, the sleepy calm of Port Stanley is shattered. The noise bothers no one. It reassures. The islanders believe themselves well defended, secure in their windswept Britishness. Britain says the islands are prepared for any future Argentine threat.
It's impossible to know what's going on behind the eyes of Anders Breivik. Hard to see if the evil he carried out haunts him, whether he hears the screams of those he killed. Breivik maintains that his horrific attacks came after he joined a network of like-minded nationalists. The police here doubt such a network exists.
So you've got to look, you've got to listen, and now you've got to talk. When you get to the edit suite, you've got to talk to whoever is cutting your package. The best reporters and correspondents that I've worked with say things to picture editors like, what shot would you like to open with? Would it help if I made the script a little shorter there? Would it work better if I switched that sentence around? Can I just look at that again? Likewise, the best picture editors aren't backwards about coming forwards and saying things like, can we save that for the end sequence? Can you put a gap in there so I can bring the sound up? Can you add a few words so I can lengthen that last shot? Now, more often than not, the edit comes at the end of a busy day. Deadlines know no mercy. Throw in a missed meal and a technical problem, and you've a recipe for stress. The edit is a difficult place. But if you want to be known as somebody who writes well with pictures, then your relationship with whoever is editing those pictures is absolutely vital. If you treat them as just a button presser, then just a button presser is what you'll get. Now, a great editor can't turn a poor script into a prize winner, but a poor edit can ruin a really good script. Here's another thing that unites the best writers. They're not afraid to write. The default BBC script is safe. Truth is, sometimes that slips over into being a bit boring. Whilst you must always be factually accurate, editorially sound, and properly appropriate, you can be adventurous. It's always best to keep your sentences short and simple, but if the pictures will carry them, slip in a simile, go mad, use a metaphor. Let the poet in you blossom. Love whatever language you're broadcasting in. Don't be afraid to try a line that just comes in and lightly kisses the pictures brighter.
The burning air yields nothing. Too many seasons without rain have turned the ground to dust. Like so much of the rest of the Horn of Africa, the lands of the Turkana are in the grip of drought. They are nomadic pastoralists who depend on the rain to provide grazing for their animals. Now they come seeking relief.
Of course, when it comes to writing for pictures, don't forget the basics. If you're just describing what the viewer is seeing, the chances are you're getting it wrong. The words want to complement the pictures and enhance them, not just mimic them. And of course, all the other basic rules of packaging apply. Be clear about what it is you want to say and structure your story. But if you think you've got a good line, try it out on the team. The look on their faces will generally tell you if it's a good one. And who knows, they may even come up with a suggestion that makes it better.
Like a rocket on the launch pad, the Phoenix escape capsule. and strapped in like an astronaut, the very first rescuer, poised to plunge half a mile under a mountain.
Even on a dank grey day, the deep gold stonework of Durham Cathedral exudes a warmth which matched the affection of those who flocked to celebrate the life of Sir Bobby Robson. Contemporaries, successors as England manager and former players all united in their esteem for a remarkable man. Inside, his family found themselves surrounded by many of the best-known figures in the game, hearing about his personal compassion and passion for football.
And here's another thing that a lot of the good people I work with do. They mutter to themselves as they write. They speak the sentences as they come off the keyboard. It's not enough that the words look pleasing on the screen. They have to sound right too. It's about the rise and fall, the rhythm and flow of the script. And of course, when you come to lay down the track, the delivery has to be right. There's no point in having a script that works beautifully with the pictures if you then deliver it in a deadly monotone. As a producer who's had nearly 100 heart attacks caused by late feeds from far-flung places, I can't believe I'm going to say what I'm about to say. But when you've finished, go back and polish. Don't be silly about it when you're hard up against the clock, but where you can, go back, watch the whole thing through, and where you can, make it better. This is something that the best I've worked with do again and again. It's as if only watching the whole thing through that they realise what needs changing. Sometimes it's just a word or two that need polishing brighter. Sometimes it's a phrase that needs honing to a sharper point. I suppose the point is for them it's about making it as good as it can be. Not just when it's the lead, but every single time.